said the 1997 incident shaped you in unbelievable ways. Can you maybe elaborate on that and how it helped shape you?
Jason, we appreciate your question. We've addressed this. It's been asked and answered, so happy to move on to the next question here.
Neil Olshey is now free to tensely chug water wherever and give angry side eye to whomever he wants, as long as it's not at the Moda Center and to Blazers employees, because in short, the Blazers said goodbye today, and Twitter nearly broke. Well, Shea wasn't even supposed to be the headline of that moment, but his very chill and very normal demeanor really stole the show. We'll get to all of that. I'm Maggie Vespa. Welcome to The Story. The contact info is at the bottom of your screen. You can email thestory@kgw.com. You can use the hashtag #TheStoryKGW. As you'll see, your feedback drives this show, and we want to know what you think of this story. Neil Olshey is out. The Portland Trail Blazers announced today they fired their general manager, effective immediately. Here's the gist. About a month ago, the team announced they had hired an LA-based law firm to look into what it's like to work for the Trail Blazers franchise. The reason? Multiple employees had alleged general manager Neil Olshey had created a hostile work environment. Specifically, as Yahoo Sports reported at the time, employees alleged a toxic, hostile work environment where staff members have been subjected to intimidation and profanity-laced tirades, among other bullying tactics. Now, tonight, the team is only saying that Olshey violated their code of conduct. They've also said they're not releasing details from the investigation that happened from that outside law firm. But about a month ago, on his podcast, Bald-Faced Truth, longtime sports columnist John Canzano interviewed former Blazers player Dan Dickow. Dickow later worked for the Blazers. He was a player development assistant during the 2011-2012 season. And during that time, he told Canzano, he reached out to a business exec within the Blazers organization to ask about potential career opportunities on that side of the franchise. This story followed.
2 days later, Neil Olshey calls me on the phone out of the blue and just rips me a new one. I mean, I don't know how many F-bombs were dropped in that phone call. And I'm a big boy. I've played professional sports. I've been in locker rooms. I've been called multiple names. I've been in heated arguments with players. I've heard multiple arguments. But for that attack to come out of the blue, just for asking a simple question, kind of where opportunities may lay for me, just blew me away and realized what in the world is going on here.
All right, so fast forward to today. The Blazers released this statement on Twitter. Again, they provided zero details about the investigation itself, but just said they are confident these changes will help build a more positive and respectful working environment. Olshey so far has said nothing. Most of the columns and posts on social media about him have a couple of things in common. First, they point out that Olshey is a former soap opera star. We just wanted to squeeze that in here. And then second, when it comes to his being fired, they are supportive of that move, to say the least. And that includes famed singer-songwriter Katie Lang, who replied to a tweet about the firing with this simple gif of Dame waving goodbye after his heart-stopping three against OKC. Dame and his teammates, by the way, also not commenting at this point. Then there's John Canzano's column in the Oregonian today. The headline, firing of Neil Olshey is a galvanizing move by the Trailblazers. And in this column, we have our quote of the day, quote, "It's worth noting that there isn't a single transaction that galvanized the NBA fan base more than this firing of Olshey. No trade or draft pick has ever been so uniformly celebrated. No hire or free agent signing has ever been so unanimously agreed upon." Now, I talked to Canzano earlier. He's in Vegas for the Pac-12 championship, and he thinks the Blazers higher-ups decided this swiftly, like weeks ago. And here's one reason why.
There's several employees that were there for the bulk of Neil Olshey's tenure who tell me they were not interviewed. This was like patient zero stuff. Like, they should have been talking to these people early on. But as I step back from that, I kind of see that, you know, maybe what they heard early on was enough. And what we have endured in the last few weeks with all the uncertainty is just, maybe they were trying to negotiate with him and buy him out and end this peacefully. and it didn't end up that way.
Let's broaden this out a little bit, okay? Because this firing comes on the heels of another really big shakeup in the Portland sports universe. This week, the Portland Thorns announced their new coach, Rianne Wilkinson. And this comes in the wake of the Paul Riley scandal. The former Thorns coach seen there was fired recently by the North Carolina Courage after multiple players accused him of abuse and misconduct. And the Thorns this week emphasized how their new coach is both qualified and a good person. They said that in their press releases, and they told that to multiple media outlets. So in short, Canzano says the standard for behavior in sports is changing drastically.
In the world of professional sports, it really is a boys' club. And I have seen, MBAs who are talented, proficient women who steer away from the sports world and have told me over the years that they do that because it's hard enough to be a woman in a Fortune 500 company. Why would you want to add on the element of being with a sports organization? And I just, that really needs to change. And I'm glad that, sports is getting some sunshine, and I think it should. And I think it's a wake-up call, not just in our region. We're seeing it across the country in sports franchises that, you have to conduct yourself in a decent way or you're going to get called on it.
Which, moving forward, brings us back to the Blazers. In Olshey's wake, Director of Player Personnel Joe Cronin will step in as interim GM. Olshey's permanent replacement is TBD at this point. So we, like you, will be watching. With that said, let's get to our big story tonight. It's an important one about a dark time in our history. By the 1920s, more than 80% of all indigenous children were taken from their homes and put into boarding schools, including some in Oregon and in Washington. A lot of those kids were abused, and many died at those schools. Now there's a mission to identify those victims who are buried in unmarked graves. Here's Edmundo Aguilar.
Perseverance could do anything to us, and we're still going to be here.
Today is the unofficial day of remembrance and recognition for what has happened in the boarding schools.
People here are remembering the stories of lost loved ones.
Makes me grateful today I'm here compared to all the ones that were taken.
Stories of indigenous children stolen from their families, forced into government-run boarding schools.
I had that haircut too.
Matilda Sampson, a grandmother and community leader, survived one of those schools. We met her here at Fort Spokane, a former indigenous boarding school.
Everything was taken from me.
Native boarding schools were created by the U.S. and Canadian governments in the late 1800s. The goal, according to the Department of Interior, forcibly relocating the children to schools where their identities, languages, and beliefs were to be forcibly suppressed.
I wasn't used to wearing uniform clothes and not allowed to talk our language or tell our stories.
There are accounts of physical and psychological abuse at these schools. Matilda, a member of a Canadian tribe called the Adam Lake Band, attended Kamloops Indian Residential School in British Columbia in the early 1970s.
They always said there was children buried behind the school.
The tragic hidden truth of some Native American boarding schools.
More than 1,000 bodies found in mass graves at schools in Canada.
Seeing the headlines about the mass graves found at her old boarding school last summer brought Matilda back.
When I first saw it, I was like, I couldn't believe it. It was so heartbreaking. I have a lot of hurt and a lot of hate. I'm angry because I was brought up with a lot of abuse.
Years of alcohol abuse, a coping mechanism to drown out the unsettling memories.
I spent too long in my life hating. That's not who I am today.
Matilda's experience at the school was not one of a kind. There were hundreds of them across North America, including more than 350 indigenous boarding schools across the United States, mostly government-funded, some run by churches. More than 60,000 Native American children were placed in these schools. That's nearly 83% of all school-aged indigenous children by the 1920s.
Here we are on the Western Navajo Indian Reservation.
Historic videos show those children side by side with government officials. stripped of their native identities, their traditional songs replaced by humiliating ones. One of those schools is still open, Chemawa Indian Training School in Salem, Oregon. It started out in Forest Grove, Oregon, about 40 miles west of Portland. More than 300 indigenous children were forced to go there. Many, like these Spokane children, never made it out alive.
This is a photograph of students who were en route from Spokane to the Forest Grove Indian School.
Ava Gugamos is an archivist at Pacific University in the city of Forest Grove.
Martha Lott, also known as Maddie Lott, died within about 6 months of this photograph being taken. We think it's probably her.
Over the past 10 years, Ava's research has been locating the remains of indigenous children like Maddie Lott.
We believe she is buried right about here.
The government relocated Forest Grove to Salem in 1885 and changed the name to Chemawa Indian School. But the mistreatment of the children continued and the number of deaths rose.
We're on sacred ground.
Frederick Lane from the Lacandon tribe attended Chemawa in the 1980s. On Indigenous Peoples Day, Lane came to Chemawa to pay his respects.
They were killed. They were somebody's child. These children were stolen. They lie right here.
For half a century, they lie here, their stories buried along with them. In the 1960s, a bulldozer was sent into the neglected cemetery at Chemawa and wiped out the original headstone plates.
And the plates were put back in an order that they assumed copied an old map.
Sue Ann Reddick, a former Chemawa employee, was distraught about the destruction of the cemetery.
These plates do not necessarily relate to the location of the remains of the children.
So we're hopeful that some of this research can help narrow down what are probably unmarked graves.
Sue Ann and Ava teamed up to convert old cemetery maps and information into a digital database to find unmarked graves.
Based on our list of who died, these ones, we don't know where they were buried. Makes me feel sad and also, I guess, honestly, just a little bit angry that more wasn't done.
Now, families from all over the country can find out who exactly is buried at this cemetery, their tribal affiliation, their burial location, and cause of death.
To stand here and think about that family coming to this school, losing that child while they were there, There aren't any words for it. It's a kind of pain that only parents who have lost their children can understand. You just wish somehow you could comfort somebody, and maybe that is the whole purpose of the work that Ava and I are doing.
We reached out to school officials to ask about Chemawa's history. They referred us to the Bureau of Indian Education, which did not respond.
I guess it's bittersweet with the sad history of Chemawa Indian School.
Lane says the Chemawa of today has evolved into a refuge for young Native Americans.
Chemawa has enlightened my ability to move forward as an indigenous person.
Today, indigenous students learn their culture and history here. The cemetery, a reminder of what the children who came before them endured.
They have no voice, but their voice is right here, right now, through the good work that we're trying to do to protect Chemawa Indian School.
I've been sober 30 years now.
Today, Matilda Sampson has found strength in her recovery and healing from a past no longer buried.
I just want to do the best I can with what I have and share it with others. But now I just got to keep moving forward. Can't keep that hate in me, because if I do, then they win.
You, our viewers, had a lot to say about the future tolls on Portland area freeways, and we're getting the feeling that many of you really don't want them.
I have a real problem with tolling.
The thing is, this has been a done deal for the past 4 years, and it actually passed through the legislature with bipartisan support. When the story continues. Lots of Blazers tweets tonight for obvious reasons, but we're not used to getting sports tweets, so we feel pretty cool right now. Welcome back, everybody. Keep sending those questions and comments to thestory@kgw.com or use the hashtag thestorykgw on Twitter. For now, let's talk tolling, because it's clear you, our viewers, want to badly. You've got a lot of opinions about ODOT's plans to put tolls on major freeways in the Portland area starting in late 2024. Drivers at that point will be tolled, ODOT says, on I-205 near the Abernathy and Tualatin River bridges. A year later, ODOT will start their regional mobility pricing project. That will impact drivers on all of I-205 up to the Glen Jackson Bridge and a big stretch of I-5 from the Interstate Bridge to the Boone Bridge in Wilsonville. All that's online if you didn't write it down. Now, a small number of you who reach out to us are on board with these plans. Jean, for instance, wrote, I can't believe how short-sighted people can be over the tolling issue. Everyone agrees that we really need new bridges over the Columbia River. If you own a car or drive, it's naive to think that you can drive without incurring expenses. And then she added, car payments, fuel and maintenance expenses, and tab fees that help pay for roads and road maintenance are an expected thing. Of course you should help pay for our bridges. That being said, Jean was kind of in the minority as far as those of you who reached out to us. Most of you were pretty against it. Jerry wrote, since ODOT is not listening to Oregonians and they're going to ramrod tolls on I-5 and I-205, colorful, Oregonians need to take a stand and let's do what we can to force the issue. Steve wrote, when you get a governor, or for that matter, a president that sneaks around everything, like the people and the Congress, everyone else starts doing it. He added, that's why you've got a highway department saying it's a done deal. We don't care what you think. We want a toll on roads and we're going to go ahead and do it. We don't need your vote. And then Paul said, last one, we're told that tolling on highways will happen no matter what. I'm curious, he said, by what specific authority does the state have authority to toll roads without a vote of the public or legislature? That's a key point in that question. Let's talk about that. Who has the authority and why is this a done deal? Well, first off, none of this has happened in secret. ODOT, or the governor for that matter, did not just wake up one day and decide to toll drivers. This has actually been in the works for years. Back in 2017, the legislature passed a transportation package called Keep Oregon Moving. It put millions of dollars in funding toward projects to solve congestion issues, and that includes tolling. And by the way, we want to point out, this package passed with bipartisan support, even though the Democrats had control. Republican Congressman Cliff Bentz, who was a state rep at the time, was one of the bill's champions, along with Senator Brian Boquist, who you might remember from this.
Send bachelors and come heavily armed. I'm not going to be a political prisoner in the state of Oregon.
Kind of a famous clip. Okay, so that again was from the Republican walkout over cap and trade in 2019. We're talking about 2017. But even though you didn't vote for tolling directly, like it wasn't on a ballot or anything, a lot of you voted for the people in office who voted for tolling. So that's why it's happening. It was passed by the state legislature. But it doesn't mean you can't still complain to ODOT about it. Under the tolling project section of their website, they literally say, we want to hear from you. Direct quote, even though tolling is for sure happening, ODOT is still working out the details about how to make it equitable, especially for marginalized communities. So you can submit your comments directly to ODOT on this page. And the agency also says they will continue offering digital opportunities to hear directly from the experts and provide valuable feedback. So keep your eyes out for those if you are interested. Meantime, if you're going to see the beach, if you're going to the beach to see the high tides this weekend, keep in mind those could end up being the low tides in the future. It's a little trippy to think about. We'll explain though. You know, if sea levels keep rising, we're going to talk about that next on The Story. Welcome back. Anyone heading to the coast this weekend? Well, if so, you might get the chance to step into the future. Stay with me here on this, okay? King tides are hitting the coast, which means the tide is going to be way, way in. And unfortunately, that's what scientists think will become the norm as sea levels continue to rise. Here's Keely Chalmers. What will our coast look like in the coming decades as our climate changes, glaciers melt, and sea levels rise? A few times every year, we get a glimpse of what that future might be. And this weekend is one of those times as the king tides come to the Oregon coast.
Well, king tides is a good proxy for what we can expect to experience with sea level rise over time.
King tides are extremely high tides that happen every year in early winter along the Pacific coast.
So you have the sun, the moon, and the earth all in alignment with each other. The moon is closest to the earth in its cycle, and the earth is closest to the sun in its cycle. And it creates the greatest gravitational pull on the tides.
Meg Reed is coastal shore specialist for the Oregon Department of Land Conservation and Development, an organization involved with the King Tides Project. For the last 11 years, volunteers with the project have been documenting these tides.
And we ask people to go out with their cameras or phones and take pictures of the king tides from a safe distance because these can be very dangerous events.
They've snapped pictures of flooded parking lots, boat ramps, and beaches. They've captured images of king tide water surrounding buildings, images of what our coast could one day look like.
And so it can cause damage. It can cause flooding and erosion and impact infrastructure. So it's important for people to be able to observe those impacts and think about adaptation strategies.
Like changing where and how we build on the coast.
Might mean you have to elevate houses or infrastructure. You might have to move that infrastructure back away from the coastline and other adaptation strategies.
Anyone can document these king tides, and community volunteers are always welcome.
Our website is OregonKingTides.net, and we have all of our information there, the dates of all of the king tides for this winter season.
Because the more we know now, the better off we'll be in the future. Keely Chalmers, KGW News.
All right, keep sending in those questions and comments to the story at KGW.com. We have an update, by the way, on our biggest tiny fan when we finish the story. Next. Quick reminder about the Hey Help campaign. This is the KGW Great Toy Drive this week and probably through the rest of the year because we love the toy drive here. And it's so easy to give this year. You can make a cash donation online by holding your phone's camera up to the QR code. It'll take you to a donation page. Or you can just skip that and go to kgw.com/toy drive. You can also drop off a toy at any IQ Credit Union, Fred Meyer, or local Toyota dealership. Okay, finally tonight, part two of our biggest tiny fan. Last night we told you Lily's parents tweeted at us saying that on Wednesday night, our show soothed their fussy six-week-old baby. As soon as the show started, Lily was as calm as can be. So last night we thought Lily would get a kick of seeing herself, her tiny self, on TV. Turns out we soothed her a little too much. Dad, Jeff, tweeted saying she was so calm by the end, she didn't get to see herself. She passed out. Point number one, Lily is adorable, and thank you so much to her parents. Point number two, are we that boring? Like, am I Bob Ross or something that I'm putting people to sleep with this show? I have no idea. Pick up your phone and follow us on Twitter. You can see the photos of Lily. We're at thestory@kgw.com. Or again, email thestory@kgw.com with your questions and comments. That does it for the show on this Friday night. The news at 6:30 with Laurel Porter starts now.
This is KGW News at 6:30.
And a big development surrounding the Portland Trailblazers. The team has fired longtime GM.